Live from our studios, somewhere in cyberspace, it's Beats and Eats, a happy hour for your mind. The virtual lounge is open, so come inside, grab a stool, and your drink of choice. Make mine a Guinness. And now, here are your hosts, Ty Ray and Nick Gelso.
It's another edition of Beats and Eats with Ty Ray and Nick Gelso in the virtual lounge. And today, we're talking about, well, let's be honest, what everybody is talking about around the nation. No, not the disaster in Puerto Rico, unfortunately.
Which is what they should be talking about.
Which is what we all should be talking about. But no, we are talking about the national anthem and the NFL players, some of them kneeling, some of them locking their arms with owners in solidarity, and the president going off on the players for kneeling and protesting during the national anthem. And I'm joined by Nick Gelso. And Nick, you bring a unique perspective to this topic because, of course, you're the owner, founder of CLNS Media. And right now you're actually covering the Boston Celtics training camp. And this has been a big topic for the NBA. Of course, LeBron James has already come out and called the president a bum, which I thought that was kind of interesting.
Course.
Called the president a bum. Hey. Of course, he campaigned for Hillary Clinton, let's keep in mind, in Ohio. So he's no fun of our fan, rather, of Donald Trump's. But let's get your unique perspective on this. I know that it's extended to Major League Baseball. The A's had a catcher, Bruce Maxwell, who became the first Major League player to kneel during the national anthem. What are they telling you out at the Celtics training camp about this whole controversy?
Not much at training camp, Ty, but a lot at media day, which one day was the day after, really 2 days after, I guess, Trump had his Twitter. And then, of course, the next day, all the NFL teams started kneeling. Obviously, I'm giving you a Celtics perspective up here in Boston, and I would say just about every player touched on it. Probably Jaylen Brown, not shockingly. He's more, not saying the other guys aren't intellectual, but Jaylen's a very intellectual guy. And Danny had said, Danny Ainge, that's the VP of operations and the general manager, had said, you know, that he had a long conversation with Jaylen, and Brad, the coach, had said he talked to the team. Their players, if they do decide to do that, which would obviously start, I guess, on Monday with preseason next Monday. One interesting question, and Ty, you could relate to this, is one of the media members asked Danny Ainge how he, I'm paraphrasing, but basically how he feels kind of, you know, now filling Red Auerbach's role. And for those Beats and Eats listeners who don't know who Red Auerbach was, and probably the NBA's most iconic coach and GM, and definitely one of the most successful, short of Phil Jackson, recently beat the record. But Red, really one of his underrated or lesser known contributions was his contributions really to equality and civil rights, having, you know, drafted the first black African-American pro basketball player. He also started the first all-black starting lineup for the Celtics, and then, of course, hired the first head coach African-American in any of the national or professional sports. So Red Auerbach, who was a Jewish guy from D.C., and not really, I guess, given enough credit for his placement in the civil rights movement back then. And he, of course, history tells us that he supported the players back then. And Danny Ainge, when asked, you know, how is it to fill Red's shoes, it was interesting. I mean, he talked about Red being pretty much, you know, an open book as far as open door policy with his players, both when he coached them and when he managed them from a GM standpoint. And, you know, Danny can only hope to do the same. Now, people talk about not mixing sports and politics. And Ty, I mean, you're a little older than me, but as long as I remember, the two have always mixed.
Always. Going back.
Yeah, what are people thinking?
Yeah. Going back to what? Before our time. Let's think about Jesse Owens at the Olympics in Nazi
Jackie
Germany.
Robinson, right?
Jackie Robinson. My God.
Jesse Owens, right?
1968 Olympics with the fist raised in the air.
Right.
It's always been a part of sports, whether we like it or not. And it's a big stage. I think politics to a certain degree. Brand new movie out called Battle of the Sexes. about Bobby Riggs and Billie Jean King. And back then it was about,
right. It looks great.
Yeah. Oh, it looks fantastic. And I hear it's wonderful.
Yeah, it does.
But back then it was about women's inequality. How common, right? A common theme that we're talking about today, because that's what these athletes are protesting, is inequality. Why is it when they face police brutality, meaning the African-American, why is it that it seems like justice isn't equally dispensed? I'm not necessarily agreeing with them. I'm just saying that that's what it's about. I guess what I'm shocked at here, Nick, is, and maybe it's the player's fault, I don't know, but it seems to me that a lot of Americans aren't educated on why these people are actually protesting or unhappy. That's the sense I get. They don't know.
Whose fault is that, Ty? Is that a media? Is that the media's fault? Because I do hear region, like locally up here in Boston, I mean, they're trying to differentiate exactly how you are. I mean, like if this isn't necessarily a slam. I mean, I guess what I'm trying to say is, whose fault is that the communication is getting, for lack of a better word, miscommunicated to
right.
sports fans and non-sports fans? Because I was shocked. I was at the game Sunday, Ty, when the fans at Foxborough booed the Patriots kneeling. I was shocked.
I think it's both parties' fault, and I know I sound like I'm straddling the fence here, but I do think it's both parties' fault. One, I think the messaging from players has been a little muddy. They haven't really came out. I think everybody's got their different reasons for doing it. And then secondly, I think I blame a lot of the fans and a lot of the American public for not educating themselves. So I think it's both parties at fault here for not understanding. And that's a shame. We have more ways to communicate now than ever. And we still can't find common ground on things or respect each other's opinions. Listen, I don't want to sound like I'm not taking a stance here. I totally understand what the players are doing. I come from a military family. My dad was Navy. I don't know if he'd agree with me on this because, you know, I don't have an opportunity to talk about it with him as he's passed on. I know back in the 70s, he would not be happy with me. I remember this is on a much smaller scale. Right. This is on a much smaller scale, but I'll tell you a story. I was, I think, 10 or 11 years old, and we were going to go on a field trip at school. And I said to Dad, well, they can't make me go. And he went through through the roof. You're going on that trip.
They can't.
So it was kind of like the old America, love it or leave it thing with him, right? And we even had a bumper sticker on my car, America, love it or leave it, when I was a kid. Now, his views evolved over time. But my point being that I don't know. I'd be curious to talk to him now whether or not he would understand what exactly the players are trying to get across. But I understand myself. I understand how military families feel. I understand how middle Americans feel. But I also understand how the players feel, because we've got a crisis in this country and we need to talk about it. And if it means that they need to kneel and be the bad guy and it brings the issues to the forefront of inequality, well, then so be it.
Yeah, I can't say I disagree with what you're saying, Ty. I mean, it's a situation where it's tough, you know, because the president is clearly waging war against sports to divert from Russia and North Korea and Puerto Rico and everything else. And it seems like, I don't know, man, it was like being in the Twilight Zone in such a liberal area as New England, as Boston. You know, I don't think that he won one county in Massachusetts, no. Right? And to see the fans at Gillette Stadium boo their own team and boo during the national anthem, which is almost equally as disrespectful as kneeling. I mean, basically, they're booing during the national anthem, right? I mean, does that even make sense? I don't even know what people are disagreeing about anymore. I think they're just disagreeing to disagree.
Here's the thing, Nick. They don't know either. Like I said, going back to earlier in our discussion, as we started this podcast, I think the messaging by the players hasn't been clear. And I think that fans and people who are non-fans who disagree with what the players are doing have not done enough themselves to educate themselves on the topic about how players or African-American players could feel so outraged. But all I know is this, is that Donald Trump, and I believe that's the first time we've used his name on this program, has galvanized the sports world unlike anybody else can. In fact, if you saw, did you see the latest cover of Sports Illustrated?
I haven't seen it yet, no.
Oh, you should take a look at it. On the latest cover of Sports Illustrated are all these players locked in arms. Of course, it's a interesting photo. You've got Steph Curry locking arms with Roger Goodell. I don't know if that it's certainly Ty, it's interesting.
Talk about it's all about what we just mentioned, the iconic, the legendary Bill Russell wearing the Medal of Freedom around his neck while on one knee. That was tweeted out and Instagrammed out yesterday. You know, there's that, we're using the word iconic a lot. I feel like we're back in season one of Beats and Eats, but there's that iconic coverage of Russell and Kareem and Ali sitting when Ali was dodging the draft, I guess. I mean, basically they were standing up for Ali. They were trying to figure it out. So Bill Russell, I mean, here he is almost, I mean, he's got to be close to 90, Ty. You know, taking a knee. So, I look at what. I mean, did you see what Greg Popovich, the coach of the Spurs, said about the whole situation? Because I really liked his comments as well.
I like him a lot. I like Pops a lot. I know a lot of people disagree with him. He was very outspoken against Trump, but he seems to be a guy that's fairly level-headed, and I take him very seriously. He is a thoughtful,
serious guy.
Yes, and so what are your thoughts on what he said?
I feel like it makes. I mean, I'm very torn on. I don't know if the players are going about it the right way in regards to kneeling during the national anthem. I mean, Popovich kind of said, "Look, two wrongs don't make a right," and we're trying to make a point, but why denigrate? And I'm paraphrasing here, basically, but why denigrate? You know, a national tradition or you know, paying homage to this country. There are far different ways we can use our audience, you know, our fan base, the people are following. We can get the word out to them without having to make such a drastic public statement, you know. And I found it to be interesting because he is an ardent Trump basher. I mean, he just does not like Donald Trump. He certainly wasn't sticking up for him. I mean, he said, you know, pretty much called him an idiot. Yeah, but I kind of agree with him there. Like, there's a point in my head where I say, you know, you're talking about when you add all the sports teams together, hundreds and hundreds of multimillionaires with, you know, just add all their Twitter followings together, you're talking about millions and millions of Twitter. They could get media access, TV access anytime they want. Is taking a knee when there's so much confusion around what it's all about, the right course of action?
Which is what I said earlier, and maybe there's a different way to go about it. Now, what I would like to see, if Trump has the stones, and I'll be that blunt, if the man has that, the cojones, why don't you invite some players from the different leagues to the White House, sit down, and talk about it. But he won't. I guarantee you.
No, instead he's uninvited.
Instead he's uninvited
players. Like I'm sorry to cut you off, you know, like, and I don't want to come to Obama at all. But President Obama, and not putting him on a pedestal, I'm not getting into that. I'm not saying who's better, who's worse, but President Obama may have handled this situation. I could see him saying to Steph Curry, please come to the White House. Don't come to receive the trophy. Don't come to celebrate. Come to talk to me and let's discuss this, you know. And in Trump's world, it's immediately, you know, put the hammer down and beat the crap out of these guys. And I'm sorry, millennials vote now, and I think that they're, as much as they pretended to love Bernie for all the reasons they shouldn't, they most certainly will support their sports heroes over Donald Trump. Not to say they won't over the presidency, the office of the presidency, but when the man who sits in the office of the president is on national television calling American heroes in many ways sons of bitches, I mean, I don't even want to hear that language. And you know, Ty, I've noticed too, since Friday when he made those comments, it's now all cable news. Have you noticed this? They're saying shit. They're saying son of a bitch. They're saying asshole. All of a sudden, it's okay. What? I mean, I wouldn't call myself a get off your front lawn old man like you. No offense, but I would say our best left not on television.
There's well, other than the MF, right? You can almost hear everything on TV anymore.
Hear your president, regardless if it's that man or not, say well, call anyone a son of a bitch and be so inflammatory. And I'll tell you what, Ty. The one thing that's not gotten enough play, it's not gotten enough criticism, was when he recently said on the 4th of July he wants to have a military parade down Pennsylvania Ave, similar to what they do, I guess, in Bastille Day or whatever in France. But can you imagine tanks and missiles rolling down Pennsylvania Ave with the with President Trump on the balcony? I mean, that looks far more like fascism or communism than it does democracy and freedom.
That's not what we do here. We don't need to do that. Our ideas are what's powerful, right? Our It's not our military might. It's our ideas that are better. We don't have to flex our military muscles to the world. They already know, by the way.
It looks like a scene out of a dictatorship movie. I just can't imagine. You know, you watch what's the name of that movie or that TV show on Amazon, that series about the Nazis and how a man in the high tower, right? So the Nazis take over America. One of the more jarring scenes in that, I think it was in season one, is exactly that scene. It's military Nazi tanks rolling down Pennsylvania Ave, as you know. I'm not saying that that's going to happen or should. I'm just saying it got missed. Right. The media missed that among all his other diversions.
Blew over it. When we come back, we're going to talk about what the president's motives might be for this lashing out at the NFL over the protests. But before we go, I'm going to give out my Twitter handle. I'm at Coug88.
And I'm at CLNS_Nick and Ty. 4 or 5 years later, it's still friggin' tricky. I can't figure it out.
It's at Beat the Letter and Eats, and we'll be right back.
Hang on, Beats and Eats. We'll be right back. We have to make some room for a sponsor here.
Nick and I will return with more witty banter, but first we've got to tell you about a solution to your meal planning all week long. It's HelloFresh. HelloFresh is bringing the freshest ingredients farm to box to your door. Wonderful meal plans, all sorts of different recipes for every taste. And get this, it's for under $10 a meal. You heard me correctly, under $10 a meal. You need to try it today, and Nick and I have a special offer for you. Go to HelloFresh.com, put in the promo code BEAT30. Once again, HelloFresh.com, put in the promo code BEAT30. You'll get $30 off your first order of HelloFresh. $30 off. This is an unbelievable offer, and let me tell you, the food is unbelievable. I do not know how to cook, and with HelloFresh, it's made me a pro in the kitchen. I also spend more time with my significant other. We're preparing meals together. This is a great offer, great food. You'll love it. Go to HelloFresh.com. Take advantage of this special offer for Beats and Eats listeners. Just put in the promo code BEAT30. Do it today. Welcome back to Beats and Eats. We've been talking about Donald Trump and his outrage over player protests in the NFL, in all sports, actually, over the national anthem. And Nick, it has crossed a lot of people's minds that Trump may be not just creating a diversion here from other issues that aren't really going his way right now, from health care to the problems in North Korea and certainly Puerto Rico. Bless those people there. But back in the early 80s, Donald Trump really wanted a National Football League team, and the NFL wanted no part of him. None whatsoever. Mm-hmm. So instead, he chose to go the USFL route, and he bought the New Jersey Generals. And the USFL, just to educate people a little bit, was a spring football league, professional football league. It was on ABC. It never had an intention of competing against the NFL. It wanted to be a standalone league, and it was quite successful.
Until
Donald Trump decided to take his team and other owners
wage war
against the NFL, wanting to compete against the NFL. But that was really never what he wanted to do, Nick. He always wanted to force a merger with the NFL to get his own team. And since then, he has hated the NFL. You could go through a laundry list of times where he's been critical of the league, and I could go on. And I really don't want it to turn it into a whole show on this, but I have to wonder if there's some motive.
It is. So you wonder if he holds a grudge from what happened in the early 80s. I'd say probably, knowing the man from the way everybody else does, how he portrays himself on television, I would say that's not unrealistic. I think that his motivation in this whole chaos, I think, is more diverting away from the poor help Puerto Ricans are getting from, you know, the Russian. I mean, Roger Stone, our boy, was just in the congressional, you know, hearing behind closed doors yesterday, right? And then there's healthcare. You know, John McCain from 3,000 miles away is blocking everything he's trying to do, and they're in the same party. God bless John McCain. Thank you. And I think he's trying to divert from that because, Ty, what – I mean, he did talk about Kaepernick on the campaign trail, but what sparked this on Friday? Where did he come from? What? Because you know he's watching something on TV or listening on the radio, and it usually sparks him. Do you know, did something happen during the day on Friday that got him off on another tangent that literally created this? Because I don't believe anybody would have knelt on Sunday or Monday had he not said any of that stuff on Friday.
I don't know. The only thing I can think of is he did his speech in Huntsville, Alabama, and it was kind of off the cuff. Yeah. It's, at least it kind of seemed like it.
Yep.
And so I think Donald Trump,
it was scary.
It was scary. It was scary, especially the tone in his voice, fire the son of a bitches. And I just think that it's such an unfortunate use of language on his part. I know one of the Seahawk players here in my neck of the woods said, listen, my mom's not a bitch. She does volunteer work for the community. She's a teacher. She's very involved. How dare you call her a bitch? And so I just
good for him.
I don't know why he went off the rails. The only thing I can think of, and you and I are huge music fans, and we love going to concerts. And so he loves to riff. Does that make sense? He loves to just play to the audience. That's the locker up bullshit. And gee, let's talk about email. We won't go there on this show. The Trump use of private emails. But anyway.
Well, yeah, I mean, look at his son-in-law. Yeah, isn't that just so hypocritical, man? Why didn't they at least learn from him? They're making – I don't want to get off on it either, Ty, but they're making – they used it majorly to get elected. And wouldn't that be enough to tell Kushner, who I'm now starting to kind of question his intelligence with some of the stupidity he's done in the last – however long? I mean, isn't that enough to say, dude, like, I know it's confusing. Sometimes I mean to send an email on my iPhone from CLNS Media, and I send it from Gmail by mistake. I mean, it could happen, but not like when you're a top advisor to the president and you just beat someone by running against the fact that she was irresponsible with emails. Like, come on.
Yeah. It doesn't make sense. It really doesn't, other than the fact it's complete arrogance, I guess. But let's not get sidetracked from what we were talking about. Mm-hmm. I just think the president was playing to that audience and got carried away. But then for him to go on from that and to send tweet after
again,
tweet, it was an obsession. He reminds me of Glenn Close from Fatal Attraction. It's like, give it a rest.
Oh, man. He's got the digits. He's got the nuclear digits. Imagine if Glenn Close did in Fatal Attraction.
Exactly.
You know, every day. I'll tell you, two seasons ago, we did an entire series on doing House of Cards recaps. I can't even get through House of Cards because it's so mild compared to what's really going on. And
And it's draining, right, to watch House of Cards with what we've got going
on.
Oh,
yeah, yeah.
So,
I mean, it's just draining to watch NBC nightly news. It's draining to watch TV. I mean, it's just, dude. Now, can I make one more comment before you move on? Or close the lounge here. And of course, you know, I always kind of go back to CNN. Why are we doing cage matches debates right now? Like, why are they debate? There's no one is running. Like, Bernie Sanders is not running for anything. Why is he debating Lindsey Graham about healthcare on CNN? And they make it look like, you know, Monday Night Raw cage match for WWE. I mean, if I'm from another country and I'm watching this crap, I'm just like, what's up with those people? Like, have you seen any of that? I mean, I put it on for 15 minutes on Monday after Media Day, and I had to change it because, and I usually like that kind of stuff, but it was so sensationalized. A debate. Like, I just don't understand where we are devolving to in what we consider to be real life and entertainment or fiction, and how they're all kind of just meshing together. And I guess Russia is winning because I'm fucking confused, man. I don't know about you, but I'm fucking confused, excuse my mouth, and I'm questioning everything that comes out of every single person's mouth. It's not just the president. It's not just Fox anymore, because I used to question everything they said. It's not just MSNBC anymore, because I questioned a lot of their super liberal. It's everybody. It's even the sports media. Like, what is going on?
Yeah, there's nobody you can trust. At least it feels like there's no one you can trust.
And no credibility.
We just sang CNN's praises over the coverage of Hurricane Irma, but I couldn't agree with you on these debates and the way that they're publicized. They're not publicized as something that's supposed to be educational. They're publicized as battles, like a boxing
fight
or UFC or WWE, and I think that that's the wrong way to go about it. It's not about winners or losers. At least it shouldn't be. And shame on CNN for doing that. And just as we're singing their praises, and I'm going to sing their praises because I think they've done the best job of covering the damage done by.
They just do very good work with that.
Because they have the resources to. Nobody
they have
else
to mobilize does. Anybody. Yeah,
they can be anywhere.
Yeah, they can mobilize anybody.
And so hopefully it will be their coverage that will force more action down in Puerto Rico, because it's just devastating to see that what almost half the country without power, half the country with what?
Dude, without like, water. They showed an aerial view last night at nighttime of what Puerto Rico looked like the night before the hurricane and what it looks like now. I mean, like, it's not only jarring, but people need to really, and I think for the most part they do. I don't know if I guess right now we're sending a fleet of Coast Guard and military people out 2 weeks later to help. I mean, but that's America. That's American soil, you know. And right now, if you saw Google it, Ty, you saw that picture the night before and what it looks like now at nighttime. It literally looks like a deserted island with a couple fires burning. You know, it's sad. It's scary.
Those are American citizens, and we can't forget that. Now, here's another scary thing is recent survey, I think it was 2016, only 40-some percent of the American public knew that Puerto Ricans were American citizens. How sad is that? And so
we could get an all-topic education. Yeah, it's horrible. I don't think we want to go there today.
Absolutely horrible. So what's going to result from this whole national anthem protest? Quick prediction on your part.
I think it's going to continue. I mean, I don't know what can be the result. Donald Trump is not going to retract what he said. He's not going to apologize for what he said. Now, he started to backtrack a little bit. For some reason, it's okay to lock arms, but it's not okay to kneel. I don't really know why. But I think it's going to continue. I think, and in hearing what the NBA players were saying on Monday, I believe opening night for preseason is next Monday, and I think you'll see. I think you might see some kneeling. I know that the front office of the Celtics and the coaching staff are behind the players and supporting them, and you saw it throughout the NFL. And you said it just 2 minutes ago. Donald Trump created unity. Never before would you see the players locking arms with the front office or the players' union, and it's happening now. There's a hell of a lot of power in the sports community. If they actually no pun intended, but if they actually do unify behind a message and clarify that message and communicate it well, I think there could be major issues, because sports fans, especially young sports fans, I mean, nothing triggers emotion like sports and music. And Trump has already attacked and created divisions in sports, music is next, man. It's only a matter of time before he starts. Could you imagine if the Dixie Chicks came out and sang a song about Trump the way they did about Bush after 9/11? He might pull the nuclear codes on them. This is just going to be a really exhausting, embarrassing, and ugly 3 more years if it lasts that long.
I'm tired. I do think that the protests will continue all the way through the NBA. I think the NFL players will continue their protests. I think maybe with the baseball playoffs, Major League Baseball postseason coming up, you could see some protests, although there's only been one person to kneel for the national anthem there. But I don't think this is going away anytime soon. I think Trump playing to his crowd stirred up a hornet's nest here.
Ty, will we see the predominantly Caucasian NHL get more participant in this movement?
That's a good question. I would say probably not, for a couple of reasons. One, I don't think it lends itself to kneeling. Right. Two, a lot of those players are from other a lot of those players are from other countries. So I don't
Canada,
know.
Right.
Yeah. Czechoslovakia. I'm just throwing out names here. Sweden.
I mean, Ty, if they usually do the Canadian and the American national anthem at every hockey game, will the players kneel during the American national anthem and stand during the Canadian? I mean, I tend to agree with you. I think hockey is going to kind of stay away from it. But then again, football, there's no more all-American sport pre-Caucasian when you're talking fan base. And those players are doing it. Then again, they got booed off the field at Gillette Stadium, the last place you would expect players to get booed. So
then again, they were thrilled when Tom Brady
I feel like this guy's going to get reelected. This is the very scary thing.
I don't know. Well, because we're going to save that for a happy show.
Well, just let's leave it with this. He said he could stand out in front of Fifth Avenue and shoot somebody, and his ratings didn't go down, his polling didn't go down. He just attacked, like I just said, a whole industry of American heroes, and his polling is going up. I don't know what's going on with this country, man, and maybe we should leave it at that and let the listeners tweet hated us, because they probably will.
Let's do that, and let's have Scott Mitchell, bartender, pour us a stiff drink.
I need a cocktail, man. The lounge, let's shut it down, man. It's over, yeah.
The virtual lounge is now closed. For Beats and Eats, I'm your bartender, Scott Mitchell. Until next week, stay cool.